So I would like to start by asking you to imagine that you are giving a presentation to non-HCI people, or that you're in some sort of social situation where you talk about your field, human-computer interaction. And it goes really well. So you explain about computers and about humans. And then suddenly some in the audience asks you, okay, I understand humans, I understand computers, but what is interaction? So what would you ask to that question? I mean, personally, realistically, I would go blank. I would probably try to improvise some answer where I would say something about the 1992 ACM curricula definition of human-computer interaction, or I would attempt some sort of circular definition by saying that interaction is the interplay between humans and computers, and I would not be particularly happy about that. So back home, I would look at my shelf for a better answer, but really common textbooks in HCI don't define interaction or present different ways of thinking about interaction in any depth. Even some of the best people in the field don't have clear answers either. So Terry Winograd in a 1990 keynote noted that Webster's defined interaction as mutual or reciprocal action or influence, so clearly humans influence computers and computers influence humans, but how and in what dimensions? So it seems that this question is surprisingly tricky, but why bother with answering it at all? So we see two reasons. First, sort of fleshing out the everyday or folk notion of interaction is a sort of natural step to a scholar towards a scholarly concept of interaction. And not having done that in the 27 years after Terry Winograd's question is just embarrassing. So we should be able to do something better than take this folk definition of interaction from a textbook. And second, I'll try to show that sort of how each of you think about interaction, how you would answer this question, what is interaction, influences the work that you are doing. So it's sort of not a philosophical dead end or just a stupid question, but actually something that fundamentally shapes how we think about HCI. So our approach to trying to answer this question is to identify concepts of interaction. And the way we think about it is that a concept of interaction needs to say something substantial about the interplay or mutual determination, we'll get back to that, that happens between humans and computers. So it's really important that it tries to go beyond this folk notion of interaction. Then it needs to say something about or help us see what are the key phenomena in interaction. It needs to say something about what is good interaction then, and then these concepts need to use all of that to show us how we can drive evaluation and design. So these concepts are sort of pretty implicit in the literature. Often they are quite mixed up. They appear in different research traditions and use quite different methods. So identifying them has required a bit of sort of excavation work. But we have identified seven concepts of interaction that in our view differ fundamentally. So you can think of interaction as a dialogue of sort of turn-taking between humans and computers. You can also think of interaction as transmission of information between humans and computers. You can think of interaction as the use, as interaction as use of tools to act and manipulate the world. You can think of interaction as adaptation of behavior to maximize utility. You can think of interaction as embodiment, already being in and acting in a material and social world. You can think of interaction as experience, the creation of expectations, feelings, and memories, and how they shape our use of computers. And you can think of interaction in a controlled theoretical sense, such as like error, minimization of error against some reference. Now, this table is in the paper and try to sort of synthesize these concepts and our analysis of the dimensions of the concept I just mentioned. I'll just give you a couple of examples of how we think about these things. So if we see interaction as dialogue, we see it as a cyclical process of communication and interpretation. So this is a view that's sort of very old, present in some of the earliest HCI writings. And a canonical version of this is shown on the slide. So it's the normal seven-stage model with these cycles of interaction between users and the top and then machines on the bottom. So this view sort of identifies to us the key phenomena interaction as a mapping going from users' intentions and goals to actions, and it identifies feedback as a key criterion because feedback is what helps people reflect on how their interaction sort of moves forward, their fulfillment of goals. So in this view, good interaction is about understandable interaction, and it's about interaction that's natural, so sort of going from goals and intentions to action requires the least effort. If we think about it in this way, then evaluation can be done, for instance, as guessability studies to assess naturalness, and you can think about doing an evaluation where it sort of looks at the different steps in interaction and try to evaluate whether they will succeed or not, as we, for instance, see in the cognitive walkthrough. Okay, we can think about this in a completely different way. We can think about interaction as the transmission of information. So here the focus is on sending messages over noisy channels. So noise can be due to neuromuscular noise, it can be due to environmental noise, or noise in expressing intentions in a computer interface. And in this way, then, these messages, senders, and receivers come to the fore. And this view also gives us a way to reason about goodness because it can help us define throughput, and then a good interface is one that maximizes throughput. So the similar analysis for the other views in the paper. The point here is that we see fundamental differences about key questions in HCI following from how we think about interaction. So for instance, think about what is the human. So some view includes the social and the physical context and are sort of unwilling to separate that from analysis of the human. That's, for instance, interaction as embodiment, whereas other views focus maybe just on some minuscule end effect, and that's the definition of human in those views. The view of computer differs quite a lot as well. Some focus very narrowly on input and output, say interaction as transmission view, but others focus much more broadly on, for instance, expectation and memories, both of which expand the scope of interaction from just being about the hands-on use of computers to something both before and after. So, I can't help noticing here that it's not like these concepts engage in very deep notions of computing, so very few of them separate cases where what you interact with is a doorknob from cases with what you interact with is a very advanced machine learning system. But anyway, they differ in other aspects of how they see computers. They also differ in sort of the boundaries of interaction. Some look at very low-level interaction. Oh, I already said that, sorry. I messed up in those things. So we'll just go to this question of goodness. I already showed you these examples of how goodness differ. So you can think of goodness as naturalness, and you can think of goodness and as high throughput. So it's a kind of interesting question whether all of these differences mean that sort of one concept of interaction is more right than another. And in our view, this is sort of a misguided or even wrong question, because all of these concepts and all of the stuff that you can't read on the slide but in the paper actually do work in human-computer interaction. So these things help us to predict, explain, describe, they help us relate empirical observations to some of those nice concepts of interaction, and they to some extent help us think about what happens when we change situations. So in a way, they help us think about design. So the point is, all of this follows from how they think about interaction. And the other point is that each of them are actually useful to HCI. Now, while these concepts differ, we haven't really progressed beyond the folk notion in this presentation so far. So let me try to explain how we do that. So we try to use the work of a philosopher called Mario Bunge, and he's written extensively on causality and other ways in which things influence each other. And he has developed this into a kind of determination, which some of the aspects or possible types of determination is on the slide. And the point here is that we can try to understand the link between humans and computers as a type of determination, how they influence each other, and how they together shape events in interaction. So the way that this goes is we can think about interaction as transmission, or you can think of Fitt's law if that's the easiest way. So the way it relates humans and input techniques is essentially statistical. So it places some upper limit on pointing performance. But it says nothing more about interaction than something about averages over multiple trials. So for Bunge, that would be statistical determination. If you think about the concept I presented before, interaction of dialogue, you can think of something like GOMS or KLM, which falls into that concept of interaction. And for these models, interaction happens in these sequences of deterministic processing steps with fixed outcomes and fixed costs. And the way Bunge thinks about that is that's a form of mechanical determination. And finally, there's the view of interaction as optimal behavior. In part, in Bunge's terminology, that would be teleological because intentions are defined as utility and sort of shapes the goal or norm of the entire sequence of interaction. But a theory like, for instance, information foraging theory uses structural determinations because it talks about individual behavior in relation to the entire environment. So for Bunge, that would be a form of structural determination. So there's more about sort of how these types of determination play out in the paper. We think besides sort of trying to address this question conceptually, what I've presented so far can be used very practically as a thinking tool because it identifies very different ways of thinking about, say, goodness in interaction. For instance, you can imagine to use it for perspective shifting. So say you've been thinking about interaction as transmission all your life. And you can actually think about, and of course then you're associated with a particular form of or notion of goodness, and you can actually think about if other perspectives like interaction as experience can actually nuance or challenge or extend that view of goodness. And we also hope in some sense that this table one is useful just as an overview of how we think about interaction. So what work is sort of left to do here? So in trying to crystallize these views of interaction, it's just super hard to do that. And we would really like to see more of what we call propositions about interaction. So for us, the proposition with a particular theorist called Dubin is a theoretical statement that links constructs and boundary conditions and overall state of a system. You can think of it more simply as sort of an attempt to say something strong and committing about interaction. And there are just really, really few of those types of statements. And you can think about it in this way. So from the Norman seven stage model of interaction, what are actually the strong predictions that follow from that work or the strong conceptual development that follows from this work? We've also tried to cover some key aspects of interaction. Of course, there's like hundreds or many, many alternative views that one could imagine. We think in particular of symbolic aspects of interaction, of multi-party interaction, and interaction as integration, as talked about by Grudin and Farouk also at this conference. And finally, there's sort of the link between views of interaction and design that I hinted at in the beginning, but that those views that or concepts of interaction that we have talked about are either what we call very high determinancy, so sort of can say something about design, but then quite limited in scope of application, for instance, interaction as transmission, or it's sort of the other way around, they apply to many situations, but can't inform design very well. So that, for me, is an interaction as a embodiment is one example of that, and you can think actually also of interaction as tool use that doesn't give us much advice in design. And for us, somehow addressing this link is probably one of the most pressing questions in HCI. So, going back to the original social situation that I'm occasionally in, what should I have answered? I could have said, following Bunge, that interaction is a form of mutual determination, that's statistical, teleological, mechanical, teleological, sorry, after all, mechanical or some other type. It spans at least 7 quite different concepts in HCI that have very, very different implications, for instance, for how we think about goodness or how we evaluate. We also believe that interaction is a useful tool for thinking about your work, for instance, using this perspective shifting I mentioned. And I guess finally, sort of interaction for us the concept of interaction is an opportunity to really develop concepts or formulate propositions. And one way we think doing that is essential to moving forward HCI as a scientific discipline. And that's all. Thanks. Questions?
So it's pretty amazing to see you're writing a paper and thinking about the fundamental topic in 2017. And there's a room full of people wanting the answer to that question. So it says a lot. So thanks for doing that. Can you talk about how did you come across those, how did you came up with those categorization, those 6-7 points that you showed about structural and all of those? Where did that come from? And I wanted to say my personal view of interaction or like this answer, like how it becomes so complicated. I feel like it's one of those things that words cannot describe it. It's one of those things that you have to experience it, and then you know what is interaction.
Yeah, sure. So we tried, so the 7 concepts came from a survey, sort of looking at textbooks, looking at concepts we really thought we should cover, because in one way or the other they've been implicit in much ACI work. And then there's some concepts, for instance, interaction as control theory, which is sort of emerging as an important thing, but which uses a very particular form of determination that's in there for that reason. So it's an attempt to sort of cover at least some of the most well-known views of interaction overall.
Okay, thanks.
Hey, hi Kasper, I'm Pedro. Thanks Kasper and thanks Antti. Mutualization, but I was wondering if you would comment a little bit on this other opposing trend, which is kind of these people like Gilbert Simondon that say like, no, this is all like integration, one thing, there's no technology, there's no nature, it's just one thing. And if that would change the way that we talk about interaction, or maybe it's just still the same thing.
Yeah, so I think in general, I mean, there's a lot of different views of interaction which flows around as names, or interaction as integration, mm-hmm. or partnership, or I think for many of those, it's very unclear when you read them what it is that they're actually saying about interaction. So essentially, what is the proposition being made about interaction? Mm-hmm. And our analysis of sort of cursory some of these views were just not fruitful in trying to explain, well, what is, if you think interaction is integration, okay, what's your commitment to good, I mean, what is good interaction then? Mm-hmm. So I think part of the sort of work here is to figure that out, and then maybe also discover that some of these ways of talking about interaction don't really sort of live up to what we call a concept of interaction.
Cool, thank you.
Great.